This is Shop Talk. I'm Ria Tanjuatco Trillo. Most parents would like for their kids to be successful professionals, but only a few would say outright that they want their kids to be successful entrepreneurs. And as our guest today will share, molding children to be enterprising isn't rocket science. It only takes about 8 simple secrets to unlock the entrepreneur in them. Joining us in this episode is Mary Joy Canon-Abaquin. She is the founding directress of the Multiple Intelligence International School. Joy is also the author of the 8 Simple Secrets to Raising Entrepreneurs. Hi, Joy. Thanks for coming on Shop Talk.
Hi.
Okay, your book looks really cool. I mean, just from the cover, it already looks like something I would want to read, and I think something that kids would want to read, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah. Actually, that's the feedback I got. Like, the kids themselves were telling me when they saw the cover, wow, I like your book. I think it's the colors.
right. It looks really, really cool. Okay, your school focuses on developing different aspects mm-hmm. of a child's intelligence, yeah. right? And there are how many types of intelligences?
There are 8.
8. Okay, yeah. And maybe you can just run down what they are for us real quick.
Okay. Well, the first is linguistic intelligence, or what we call the word smart for kids. Mm-hmm. And these are kids, you'll know them right on the bat because they're always telling stories, they're always asking questions. And then you have the logical mathematical kid, which kids are very good in numbers, with numbers. And oftentimes, this is an intelligence that they associate with being good entrepreneurs because it's, because of their ability to think about cause and effect as well. And there's picture smart or spatial intelligence. These are kids who always are very good in the arts or always need something visual to learn.
Okay.
And then musical intelligence, favorite among kids. Everybody thinks they're musically strong.
Everybody wants to be a rock star, right?
Yeah. So ironically, kids who are really strong in musical intelligence learn through music, like even their multiplication table, they'll probably sing.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Then the bodily kinesthetic child, body smart kids, you'll see them because they're always very good in sports.
Okay.
And they love movement. And then the nature smart or the naturally intelligent child. These are kids who like science. On the other hand, they're always asking for a pet. They're always they're oftentimes dirty in the playground because they're exploring or planting. And then the two personal intelligences, which is people smart and self smart. So the interpersonal child oftentimes is a good leader. They get other people to follow them, works cooperatively. And the self smart child, my favorite, they're oftentimes quiet in class, but they have a very good understanding about themselves and they work very well with others.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Of course, everybody has an aspect of each of those in them, right?
Yes.
It's just in varying degrees.
Yes.
Okay. Is there any particular intelligence which is preferred for entrepreneurship?
Well, my personal view is, I think as a parent and as a teacher, is that we don't box kids and say, oh, only those who are very good with logical math or number smart can mm-hmm. be an entrepreneur. I think the challenge is to find kids, to find in the child their strength, that the children understand what their passion is, what their interest is, what their strong intelligence is. And as the adult in their life, whether you're the parent or the teacher, to give them opportunities to build that. I always tell them the simple formula is I plus I equals I, meaning what is the intelligence? What is the interest? And oftentimes they come up with their idea. Because there's some kids who are strong in an intelligence, but they're totally not interested in it. Mm. So it really has to be a combination of both so that they can find their passion.
So that actually happens in a person. You could be good at a mm-hmm. particular thing, but you don't like it.
Yes, yes.
Okay. What do you do with a kid like that?
You know, that's what's funny. In our school, we have what we call mentorship. So it's really your choice where you want to go for a mentor. And for a time, the teachers would say, can we just have the best of the best and mentor them? But when the kids sign up, especially in our ensemble, which is a musical ensemble, there are lots and lots of kids who are very interested in it, but they're not necessarily the best kids for the ensemble. But because they love it, they eventually learn how to do it well.
Okay.
And I think
so, follow your passion.
Yeah,
right?
The same with business, right? Sometimes, you know, you're a doctor, but you're passionate about photography. You're mm-hmm. a so-so doctor, but you'll be a great photographer.
Yeah. Okay, for example, let's say a child mm-hmm. Has a strength in a particular kind of intelligence mm-hmm. and is not so great at another one. Mm-hmm. is it better to necessarily build on the strength, or, you know, to sort of balance the child out, should you give more energy to develop whatever she's weak at?
You know, it's a simple question of half full, half empty. I'm always a half full person. So I really want to build on children's strengths, because that's where they're most comfortable with, and that's where you can really build a lot of confidence and self-esteem. What we tell our children is that when you are aware of your strengths, you can use it to overcome your weaknesses. And so, you know, kids are always, you know, when parents always focus on what kids can't do, it's so much easier, right? You say, you're not so good in this, so I get you this kind of help. Or, you know, I want you to learn this skill, and you give them that opportunity. We sort of really have to do a big paradigm shift in our head as parents. And instead of looking at what our kids can't do, we have to look at what they can do. Right. Because once we focus on strengths, it becomes so easy. It's a language for kids. And then they discover that, you know, oh, wow, I'm so interested in this, that it's effortless. They develop actually very good, a very good entrepreneurial mind alongside their strengths.
Okay, you mentioned, you know, overcoming your weaknesses through your strengths. Can you give us like a specific example?
Yeah, my favorite example is math, because a lot of kids are not, you know, they feel they're not very good in math, right? And but they will easily tell you, teacher, you know, I'm picture smart or I'm music smart. So what we tell them is that whatever it is that you're strong at, use it to overcome your difficulty in math. So I have some kids who will actually learn the multiplication table through a song,
okay,
because they're music smart.
Right.
Or if, you know, they're very visual children, to learn math they have to draw and to really figure out what's going on. And so we avoid what we call learning gaps. So kids leave classrooms with full understanding of what's going on. And I think that's what school should be about, that kids come in, they enjoy because, you know, it's something that is relevant to them, and that the goal of really using multiple intelligences in the classroom is really for them to gain understanding. That's the main goal.
Right. But is that possible to do in a classroom with, I think, the population of each classroom in your school
20.
Is like 20?
20,
okay.
25.
And of course, everybody has a different strength,
yes,
right, and a different weakness. So how does the teacher put that all together so everybody learns according to whatever their smarts are?
Yeah. So we use the different intelligences as entry points to a lesson. So it's like a menu of things that a child can use so that they will learn something in the classroom. So even if that's not your strength, but the teacher gives it as a way to learn a concept, I think since we all have all the intelligences anyway, so kids sort of latch on and are able to have an entry point to a lesson.
Oh, so in the classroom, they're actually given options.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, moving on to the actual entrepreneurship, why is it you think Pinoy kids are not yet, let's say, perfectly trained for becoming entrepreneurs?
Well, I think it's our culture in general. That's why I think I really took time. I felt very strongly that a book for parents should come out, because the demands for children now are going to be very different from the time, you know, the time when we were studying.
Yeah, so everything's changing so quickly.
Yeah, so the kind of mind that would be needed for, I think, the 21st century is very different. It has to be a mind that's innovative. It's a mind that is able to problem solve. If you look at all the other Asian countries around us, you will see they're, you know, really surpassing the Philippines in all ways. And I really believe that the Filipino child is a very talented and capable child. It's just that they are not given the opportunities that the other kids are given. So one of the things that why we are a progressive institution in this country and why we pioneered this kind of education is because we feel that it's a way to really prepare our kids to be global citizens and future leaders, because that is sort of attuned to what's happening in their generation. So one of the things that we fail to do as parents is to allow our kids to have a voice. I think oftentimes we always tell our kids, shh, quiet, listen, you know. And so even in the classrooms, it's like that. And I think it's about time that kids are given opportunities to be creative and innovative. It's okay if they make mistakes. It's okay if the first idea doesn't work out, because then it teaches them that they can problem solve and create new things.
Right, and often, you know, in very traditional schools,
yes,
the setup just doesn't allow for that,
yes,
right? Okay. Now, based on your book, what are your suggestions for raising an entrepreneurial child?
Well, I think as a parent, the first thing that you should really look at is your child's strength, as okay. I've said. Know your child, discover what they can do, and then give them opportunity accordingly. Like, in my case, I'm not very strong in music, but my two kids are very strong in music. Okay. So they like composing songs, they like playing instruments. So unless I'm aware that my kids are different from me, I'm never going to give them that kind of opportunity because I don't think it's important. So I think the parent has to be attuned to what the child's strengths are to be able to give opportunities. And second, to really, in your household, encourage creativity and innovation.
How can you do that?
In very simple things, you know. When for example, my daughter, one time, she was listening to, it was a pitch to ask for scholarships in her parish. Okay, and she's a little girl, and she was saying, how much is that? How much is that? And I was like, you know, she goes, how much do I have to save every day? I go, 20 pesos, and you can send the child to school. And she's like, that's my ice cream. So she was saying in her head, because you bother to explain how things work, she can never compute that big amount. But when she realized 20 pesos is my ice cream that I eat every day, I don't mind sacrificing that.
Okay, and something she can quantify.
Yes, and then she can use it to problem solve. She says, another kid can't go to school, and if I just give up my ice cream, there's enough 20 pesos to put together to make this happen. And so it's really empowering kids. And that happens when you communicate with them. So listen to their ideas, because sometimes initially you'll think, oh, you know, how big or how strange. But actually they can be very good ideas once you try to guide them into translating these ideas into actions.
Yeah, and I think me personally, as a parent, you get surprised with what your kids can understand.
Yes.
You know, you tend to say, no, I'll explain it to you when you're older, you won't understand. But when you do try to explain things to them, they actually understand a lot more than we give them credit for.
Yes.
But as parents, how is that now if, for example, the parents themselves are not entrepreneurs? Mm-hmm. Can they still train their kids to be, business people with their own businesses?
That's why the book's here.
Okay, great.
And to help guide you as a parent. Because one of my favorite parts in the book, because I myself did not realize that, is the money smart part. I don't think as parents we're very conscious about teaching our kids the value of money. And it comes in very simple forms. Simply, you know, when your child first comes to you and asks you for a toy, just the difference between a need and a want is already the beginning to teaching your kids about financial literacy.
Great. Okay, we are going to talk more about this very interesting book. We're going to take a quick break now. Stay tuned. Shop Talk will be right back.